forever near me, breath of heaven. Breath of heaven, lighten your darkness, pour over me your holiness, for you are holy. Breath of heaven. Breath of heaven. Breath of heaven. Breath of heaven.
This is a Alabama song that I dearly love. Hard to see out there.
Okay. That's good. That's a good thing.
Yeah, I call it Christmas in Dixie. Now in New York City, there's snow on the ground, and out in California, the sun shines falling down, and maybe down in Memphis, the Graceland's all in line. And in Atlanta, Georgia, there's peace on earth tonight. Christmas in Dixie, it's snowing in the pines. Merry Christmas from Dixie to everyone tonight. It's windy in Chicago, the kids are out of school, there's magic in Motown, the city's on the move, in Jackson, Mississippi, to Charlotte, Carolina, and all across the nation, it's a peaceful Christmas time. Christmas in Dixie, it's snowing in the pines. Merry Christmas from Dixie to everyone tonight. And from Blue Ridge Baptist Church, Merry Christmas tonight.
Right. right, that's fantastic. All right, good deal. All right, let us share the Christmas story together in Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 20. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, to the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary and was pledged to be married, pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you, and you will find the baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom His favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone to heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread word concerning what had been told them about the child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured all these things in her heart and pondered them. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. All right, let us stand together and sing. We're going to sing "Hark the Herald Angels Sing," hymn number 88. And let's sing all three verses. 1, 2, 3. "Hark the herald angels sing." Join in standing. Here we go. Sing out.
"Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King."
Second.
"Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail incarnate deity. Please man with men to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King."
On the third.
"Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Late and life to heal he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to give them second birth, Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
All right, you may be seated. This time we're blessed to hear Clarence.
Eskimos, everybody knows a turkey and some mistletoe will help to make the season bright. Tiny tots with their eyes all aglow. Sleep tonight. They know that Santa's on his way. He's loaded lots of toys and goodies on his sleigh, and every mother's child is gonna spy to see if a reindeer really know how to fly. And so I'm offering this simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you. They know that Santa's on his way. He's loaded lots of toys and goodies on his sleigh. And every mother's child is gonna spy to see if a reindeer really know how to fly. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you. Christmas to you.
Thank you, Clarence. That was great. All right. If you grab your hymnal again, we're going to sing again. Silent Night, hymn number 91.
Tender and mild, heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace.
On the third,
silent night, holy night, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from thy holy face, the dawn of redeeming grace, Christ the Savior is born, Christ the Savior born.
On the fourth,
silent night, holy night, wondrous star, lend thy light, with the angels let us sing, alleluia to our King, Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born.
All right, you may be seated this time. As we come to Christmas, we always remember that Jesus came with a purpose, and that was to share God's love with each and every one of us. But it also, his purpose in mind was to redeem us, and that would involve his sacrifice and, praise the Lord, his resurrection from the grave. And so at Christmas Eve, we always celebrate the Lord's Supper too and remember his sacrifice for us. Paul reminds us of what the Lord's Supper is all about in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He shares, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" This time I'd ask Jim Harris, come and help me, and if he'll just lead us in a word of help me as we share the utensils with you all, and then pray over the bread and the wine, which symbolizes his body and his blood for each of us. There you go, Jim. You pass those, and I'll take. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. At this time?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Yes. That's okay. That's all right. Don't want to leave Linda out. That's good. All right. This time, Jim, will you lead us in a word of prayer for the bread, which symbolizes his body, which is broken for us?
Heavenly Father, we come together this time of the year to especially honor the blood that Jesus shed on the cross and the crucifixion, not because of something he did wrong, but for payment for our sins. Father, a gift that we can never repay. We just thank you for each and every gift. Bless each and everyone here this night and give us all a safe trip home. We ask it in Christ's precious name. Amen.
All right. And Jesus said, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Well, yes. There you go. And likewise, he took the cup, and saying the cup symbolized his blood and his sacrifice for each and every one of us. And let us pause and remember his blood, which brings us forgiveness of sins. He ultimately was the complete sacrifice and what it took for us to have a relationship with God. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you that you're willing to shed your blood for each and every one of us so that we could be forgiven, have a new relationship, and so that we could know you for eternity. And you can work in our life. And so we thank you for that sacrifice. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Jesus said, take and drink. This covenant is new covenant in my blood. Take and drink in remembrance of me. Thank you, Jim. All right, I want to share with you briefly a story. We learned the other day as we were looking at some Christmas trivia, and what is the day after Christmas in England called? It is called Boxing Day. And that's when the relatives get together and fight it out over all the feuds they've had the day before. Or they return everything, I'm not sure, or they put everything back up, but it's known as Boxing Day. And the story I want to share with you tonight is after Christmas. And it was the appropriate time for baby Jesus to be presented in the temple, as was appropriate. And they encountered a man by the name of Simeon. Let me just share the story briefly. It's in Luke chapter 2, beginning with verse 21. It says, on the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise him, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he had been conceived. When the time of their purification according to the law of Moses had been completed, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem named Simeon who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was a custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all the people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to the people of Israel." And the child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." He prophesied about him. And as I read about Simeon, you know, one of the interesting things to know about people is their name. Why did you have your name? I know when a baby's born, sometimes you can find baby books, whether they have spiritual connotations or just names, background. People pick names that think will be noble and wonderful children and have great meaning so you can brag on them. At least that's what you're told. And I wondered when Simeon was born and they looked at him in the crib and they thought about what they would name him. And you know, every child is precious in the sight of God and precious to their family members. But we have to be honest, not every baby is as beautiful as every other baby. And so when they looked at this little baby, they thought about what to name him. And I'm sure the mother said, you know, maybe we ought to call him David, because David was a man of God. That was great, father like that. And you know, all the ladies were crazy about David because he was so handsome and good looking. And the father said, well, maybe not. And she said, what should we name him? Simeon. Well, what does Simeon mean? Simeon means little hyena beast. That's what Simeon means. So somehow the mother said, oh, well, he'll be a good fella. So they named him Simeon. And so that was his name. And I love that. Now, there are several Simeons in the Bible, so it was still well thought of. One of them, he's one of the 12 tribes of Israel. In fact, his story, if you remember Joseph, he got sold into slavery, and things went from bad to worse, ended up in prison, and then God blessed him, and he rose up, and then his family was in famine looking for food, and they ran into Joseph. They didn't know it, and so Joseph wanted to see his younger brother, and so he kept Simeon and another brother and said, y'all go back home, and I'll let him go free, but only if you bring Benjamin. Simeon was one of the ones stuck there, but that wasn't this Simeon. This Simeon was in the time of Jesus, and as mentioned, he was a righteous man of God. He loved God, and he served God. And God had given him a message in his heart that before you die, you will see the Son of God. You will see about him. And another thing we know about him was he was someone, and this phrase always interested me, he was waiting for the consolation of Israel. Now, what is that? I know what a consolation prize is. That's what you get when you don't win. But a consolation of Israel was something more than that. In the last year or so, I've noticed something interesting, and that is they have a charity for Jewish folks in tough situations. And one of the scriptures they quote again and again is this, which says, "Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sins have been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins." And that is Isaiah 41:2. And they use that verse, comfort, comfort Israel. And they're thinking about a good thing, which is to offer comfort to people that are in need and hungry. And we ought to do that. Jesus said that. You ought to look after the least of them. When you love them, it's like you're loving me. But that's not what this passage was talking about. He was looking, this is a passage about the consolation of Israel. What is that? That is the coming of the Messiah. The coming of the Messiah, God's very own Son, to redeem the people of Israel, and most of all, to know forgiveness of sins. Now, many folks misunderstood this. In fact, in the New Testament, in the Gospels, it says at several points, people wanted to gather him up and do what to him? Not to kill him, they wanted to make him king, because they thought he'd lead an uprising. And they thought the consolation of Israel was going to be their nation being freed and having a political force or power and not to be downtrodden by the Romans. But God had something else in mind. David, a man after God's own heart who failed much, but he truly loved God and cared for God, talked about the biggest burden in his life in Psalms 38. He says, "My guilt overwhelms me like a burden too heavy to bear. My wounds fester and are loathsome because of the sinful folly. I am bowed down and brought very low. All day long I go about mourning. My back is filled with searing pain. There is no health in my body. I feel feeble and utterly crushed. I groan in anguish of heart." Why did he hurt in all that way? Because sin weighed him down. He knew he had disappointed God. He disappointed himself. He was guilty. He was burdened. And he didn't know what to do about it. God did. God had a plan for all of us to redeem us from ourselves, for us to know his grace and his love. And what was that plan? That plan was his son, Jesus Christ. Isaiah goes on in Isaiah chapter 53 to talk about what God had in mind for the Messiah. The Messiah was not going to come and bring a political revolt. He was going to do this. Isaiah 53, verse 4, "Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet he was considered, they considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that was brought that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all like sheep have gone astray, each of us has turned to his own way. But the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." The Messiah came to bring us forgiveness and restoration and hope and to give us a new start in a relationship to God. That's what the Messiah came to bring and to redeem us. And that's what Simeon was looking for. Now, Simeon's name means hyena, young beast hyena. But you know what it also means? It means one who hears. And you know, if you listen to the story of Simeon, several things. One, God spoke to him and said, "Before you die, you're going to get to see the Messiah." And he did. "I'm going to reward you and let you see the Messiah." And not only that, some have asked, how did he know of all days to be there? Now, it said Anna, who's going to see the Messiah, was always there. It doesn't say Simeon was always there. He was devout. He was righteous. How did he know to be there? It says the Spirit spoke to him. And when the Spirit spoke to him, you know what he did? He listened. That's what his name was, the one who listens. He not only listened, but he obeys. And he came that day, and he heard God's voice, and sure enough, that's how he knew this child was the Messiah, the one to come. And he lifted him up, and he told his parents, he's going to do great things. He's going to create a great commotion, but God's going to do mighty things through him. And as we come to this season, let us remember that Jesus came to be our Redeemer, to Savior. But you know what he also came to do? He came to call each and every one of us. Now, Jesus came to live among us. He preached the good news. He encountered people face to face. He healed the sick. He blessed the children. He encountered folks. He comforted them. And he came to them. But God still does that, doesn't he? In his Spirit, the Spirit of God. He speaks to all of us. He speaks to us through his word. He speaks to us in our hearts. And what does he do? He calls us. He calls us to be forgiven. He calls us to be encouraged, to be restored, to give guidance. And during this Christmas season, let us be like Simeon. Let us listen to the voice of God. And let him remind us that he loves us, that he sent a Redeemer for us, and that he has plans for us. God had great plans for the life of Simeon, and God has great plans for each and every one of you. That's what Christmas is about. Jesus came, and he came for each and every one of us. The only question is, will we receive him, and will we follow him? Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for Christmas. We thank you for the chance to celebrate your name and to rejoice in your love for all of us and to share that good news so that the world can be changed and transformed and the world can know the love that we know in you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right. At this time, we're going to share in our lighting of the candles, and then we'll sing Joy to the World. Clarence and y'all, do y'all get candles? All right. Good deal. Here we go. All right. So we'll take a moment. Don't set each other on fire. And And I forgot how you do. Let the person light you. When you hold your candle straight up when it's lit, let the person do that. That way you won't drip wax on them. And then once we're all lit, we will, there you go. That's exactly right. There you go. Thank you, Clarence. Oh, do you want one? Oh, you gotta play. Yes. Okay. Y'all ready? Ready, Miss Linda? Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room.
Don't do it. guitar and you got 5 months. So
yeah.
Get back in the head.
They still got it.
We are good.
They still got it.
Yeah. All right. You're educated.
That's not very good.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
In your thing, I'm going to
hold on. I go back to the doctor this week, so we'll kind of get some guidance on that.
Yeah.